This is Philip H. Anselmo.
Hey, everybody, this is Ricky Rackman from Headbangers Ball.
Hey, guys, this is Aaron from Betraying the Martyrs.
Hey, what's up? This is Mike D. from Killswitch Engage.
Hey, this is Scooter Word from Cold.
And you are listening to...
Talk to me. With Joshua.
What is up, congregation? Welcome into Talk to Me, episode 226. The guest this week is Corey Brandon of Norma Jean. This interview is done by our friend of the show, Rico Kohler. And while I was at Louder Than Life, getting a lot of video content and some good interviews, I left the show in our friend Richard's hands. And let's see what Rico can do. Rico has his own podcast coming out, so we figured we would give him a shot here on the Talk to Me podcast. And while I was away doing some cool stuff at Louder Than Life, he did the interview. But first, let's talk about our good friend down in Atlanta, Georgia. Yes, that is Scott Bowling with Good Company with Bowling.
My name is Scott Bowling. I have a show called Good Company. Good Company is a show where we film artists in the rock genre, and we talk about their first record all the way to where they are now. We've interviewed bands like Korn and Seven Dust and Rich Ward. You can find me on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook under Good Company or Good Company with Bowling. So please, if you get a chance, check it out.
Good Company!
Make sure to head over to YouTube, search out Good Company with Bowling. Also go to scottgoodcompany.com, let him know that the Talk To Me podcast sent you. And then you can also head over to merchlive.com. Shop till you drop while you're over there. Use the promo code TOOMEY10. That is TOOMEY10. That is 10 at checkout for 10% off your entire order. And you can shop for bands like Metallica, Five Finger Death Punch, Pantera, Black Sabbath. So many great bands. Fill your closet full of metal t-shirts like mine already is. So yes, merchlive.com, TOOMEY10 at checkout for 10% off your entire order. Yes, that is merchlive.com. Promo code TOOMEY10 at checkout for 10% off your entire order. So again, next week I will be back with my Louder Than Life recap episode. Also had a quick interview with Chris Motionless of Motionless and White. That was a fun interview to do. Make sure you're hitting up the Talk To Me Congregation Facebook page or the at Talk To Me Podcast Instagram page for all the videos from Louder Than Life. Got some time with John 5, David from Dead, AJ from Fire from the Gods, picks with Phil Anselmo. It was such a great weekend, and I can't wait to break it all down for you next week on the podcast. But for this week, we turn the reins over to friend of the show, Rico Kohler. Ladies and gentlemen, Norma Jeans, Corey Brandon, how are you, man?
Doing good, brother. Doing really good.
Nice. You mentioned earlier you were having a bachelor's week because your family's out of town. How's that going? Is it kind of a nonstop bro down kegger, or is it?
I recommend to anybody that's married, in a relationship, whatever. It's good to you know, send let the wife go on a trip, or you go on a trip, whatever. Like, separation is actually kind of good, and you get some time to yourself or whatever. And so, yeah, you kind of think like, oh yeah, I'm going to hang out with my dudes all day. But I ended up just doing a lot of work, and I started doing some messing around with some solo stuff and just a bunch of stuff that, you know, I don't have to work out a schedule in any way. I can just do it whenever I want. And I stayed up for the first two nights, two days straight doing that kind of stuff. And finally I just slept all day yesterday, and then I'm back at it today. So it's been pretty chill. It's been cool.
Nice. Nice. Do you mean by solo stuff? You talk about 100 Sons and the many, like, where you got like three other side projects going, or do you mean the Corey Brandon band?
Yeah, the Corey Brandon band. That's a good one. Yeah, the CBB. No, 100 Sons is doing stuff too. We're doing some demos right now. That's, you know, the side passion project. And the solo stuff is really, you know, just as a songwriter, I write tons of stuff. Like, I don't know what ideas I'm going to have at any given time. So I record them all, you know, into my phone. I'll hum it or something. And then later I'll, you know, transpose it or whatever into guitar, try to figure it out and decide where it goes. It's either going to be Norma Jean or Not Used. Most of the 100 Sons stuff, the way that band works is Chris is writing stuff at home and he's sending it. I just get to be a singer, and the way our dynamic works is really great. And since that's still kind of a heavy band too, it doesn't cut into Norma Jean style stuff. You know, we're like, oh, that could have been a Norma Jean song. It's like, no, because Masters wrote it and I just sang on it. So it's really just a bunch of random collections of stuff that didn't work for anything over the years. And I just want to do something with it. It's not like super serious, but it's just something I can do. And it's me and my brother hanging out and seeing what comes out.
Nice, nice. Yeah. With 100 Sons, like, Legs is from Canada, and is it the bass player? Like, he's overseas somewhere?
It's me, Chris, and Legs, really. And then we have different guys that play with us. But everyone's Canadian except me. And the guy that's played bass with us before, he's kind of all over the place. But, yeah, he is an English guy. He lives in the U.S. But yeah, it's really essentially it's me, Chris, and Legs, and they're both Canadian, and I'm in the South.
Right,
America South. Anyway,
me too. So I called you guys with Fit for a King last month in Nashville.
Yeah.
And the second you guys came on stage, I was reminded of something you said in the liner notes of Polar Similar. You said, Norma Jean is a collective of musicians in which association is flexible and creative direction is shared across the history of family and friends.
Yeah.
And then you guys came out on stage, and I definitely didn't recognize anybody. And I was like, missed that. Was that by design, or just because it's, you know, kind of a rotating door of members and people have stuff going on?
It's just for us, we found out a long time ago that it's way easier to just let it be kind of an open door. So it's not necessarily that we just don't embrace the typical kind of, here's the guys, here's the faces, Beatles model of promo pics. And that's, you associate these guys with this music. So we just call it's really just five people or six people. I mean, on this album, on the last album, it was like seven or eight different members, past and present. And some that people don't even know that have worked with us before, specifically my brother, who did all the writing with us and wrote, you know, helped us structure the songs, but played drums until we got to the studio. And then Matt Marquez jumped in, and Matt has played with us plenty of times. If you didn't recognize him, it might have just been that you might have not seen us during that era. But he was with us, Meridional into Wrongdoers, and then he went and did something else. And it's just easier to stay friends and not have to like, hey, you're committed here, and if you leave, you know, we're done.
Right.
I just really like the we can just be musicians, individual musicians, and the collective thing is just a better way to explain that it's a lot of people over a course of time that are in and out whenever they feel like it, and we support them and whatever they want to do, you know, instead of it being like always a sad thing or like,
yeah,
you know, a bummer that this guy wants to go do something else. Like, yeah, go start a family and we'll collaborate down the road, I'm sure.
Oh, no, that's perfect.
Yeah, it's just, and that's the Norma Jean sound. It works that way. So it ends up bringing a lot of fresh air into the room, I think.
Yeah, no, that's perfect. My wife won't think it's perfect because we went to the Oh God, the Aftermath show, and she was expecting to see Chris Day, the guitarist.
Yeah.
That's her favorite member. Like, her thing, her whole thing is that dude couldn't be any less pretentious. Like, he is who he is, and he's fun and lovable, and, like, he wasn't there. And she was like, oh, no. I mean, she was totally into Philip. You know, he was amazing, but, you know, still, she was like, at least he's still there. And then, wah, wah, wah.
Yeah. And that's just the thing. It's like, you know, Philly needed to do some family stuff. And I didn't want it to be a conversation of, well, and same with Chris, you know, there's a whole family thing there. And I don't want it to be like, well, sorry, dude, you can't do that. But it's, you know, yeah, it's unfortunate, and in that sense, and so if we're gonna have that model, I can't be like, no, you have to embrace what we do, and the way we do it. It's totally okay with me if someone's a little bit like, oh man, I was kind of hoping that guy was here. It's like, yeah, me too. If it could be that dude and all of these guys, and you know, there are 15 of us up there, or something.
No,
like,
no, I mean, it honestly,
I would do that.
As soon as you guys kicked into a song, I was like, yeah, I'm over it. This is great. You know?
That's it too. Is it's the right people, and I really do believe that it's the right people at the right time, and just kind of roll with it.
For sure.
I'm one of those guys too. I came into the band after someone else, you know. I'm just that model started with me. So and we were just friends. So I just embrace it, and that's the best way to explain it, but I don't know, there's probably not really a way to define how the band actually works.
I guess you for sure. I mean, like that's why I'm glad you used the word family. You know, I mean, other than your brother, you guys are obviously aren't blood. So I was going to go into some of the members and stuff, but I started doing some research. And this number could be off, but it looks like you guys have had a total of 21 total members. 13 members, 8 boring. Which my band, when I told you with Chris, we had revolving door. There were several drummers, and we got, you know, plenty of jokes.
I'll say this too, like, members is because, like, if you look at Wikipedia, they're gonna put like a guy couldn't do one tour because of a family thing, and he's getting put on the Wikipedia. It's like, well, that's gonna happen to us because we have the open door
concept. Right.
But like, we know tons of bands that are like, oh, that band has a fill-in for this guy right now. He's not a member. So there's some of that a little bit.
No, I get that. And I picked up on that.
So. Yeah, so that's definitely happened too. So some of those names you'll see on there is just that happening.
Oh, no, I feel you. And but with the actual members thing, though, you guys almost have kind of a Spinal Tap thing going on with your drummers, but instead of spontaneously combusting, they just join Every Time I Die.
I think that is so. I kind of wish Every Time I Die would embrace it as much as I do, because I just think it's really. And then we had one of their drummers. Like at one point, we just traded drummers, basically.
No, I know.
Yeah, you know, Legs jumped in on a tour for us, and that's really when we started like saying, fuck it, like let's just let you know, because we don't talk about the inner workings of the band. You don't see big announcements anymore, and we don't like to do it. So, because it's to us, it's more like, do you like the music or not? Like that's the more important thing. The sound that's being made, and it's like at that point, as strong as a word as this is, the members that created it are become a little bit irrelevant is such a strong word, but it is that,
right?
Because do you like the music or not, the sound that's being made,
right?
That's the question that I would always ask with any artist is, do you like the thing that they made? And if that's what it is, and even if it's just like the one thing that you like, everybody has that too, is like their favorite album. I have those bands too. You don't have to, we don't need anyone to be loyal to us as people or the music. You can like what you like and not like what you don't like.
For sure. But don't act like you weren't a little bummed when Darcy and James Iha left Smashing Pumpkins. Like, don't act like it wasn't like, or it did not matter.
Yeah, it was a, yeah, for Manic sure.
Is in Soma after that.
For sure. I'll say this on that note, is there are personalities that need a certain other personality in the room. Of someone who's able to tell someone like Billy Corgan no on some things, you know?
If I tell him no, I think he's kind of a...
He's definitely the songwriter, the leader of what Smashing Pumpkins does, but I think what made that band what they were with those members was that those people were able to curve his talent, ego? I guess. Oh. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Oh. Sure. Oh.
No.
Sure. Well, you know what I mean? Even if they maybe weren't writing as much, there's a style thing there, but that I think he needs a little bit. So with us, I just try to find people that work with that dynamic, and it makes sure that I embrace ideas from everyone. We try everything. And so it works. It works like that. And I think the music speaks for itself on that front.
Yeah, no, for sure. This was a side note, and we kind of got off track from this, but I just don't want to miss out on this. But I noticed, I went back and watched the If You Got It at 5, You Got It at 50 video. And obviously I had no idea, you know, who anyone was outside of you guys when I saw the video back in the day when it was a fresh single. But I noticed Philip is actually a prominent guy in the video. He's one of the guys like spewing milk, you know. I was like, oh wow. Yeah. he meant the family and, you know, friends thing, like so he was part of the circle anyway, right?
Yeah, he was already, what, I've known Philly for years and years and years. I wouldn't say we grew up together, but for instance, we were young and got getting into music together and part of the same scene. So when and you'll notice this too, if you ever met Philly, and I know you've met Durr because you know his personality. Think about us choosing that personality to fit in that spot now.
Perfect.
It works. Yeah. And that's what we're looking for. Because, look, I could post on Facebook, hey, we need a guitar player. And 1,000 people would reply, and one of them would work. There's a personality thing. There's a vibe thing. There's chemistry with mm-hmm. with artists and music. So that's what we look for, is that chemistry and that, you know, friendship that we would have that would work for what Norma Jean does. And then, you know, we make Polar similar, and it fits right in with that's the next thing that comes after Wrongdoers. And then I think All Hail is that's what comes after Polar similar. It's we're on track. It works that way. And it's just for us, it just feels right to do that and just be kind of loose about it. And you know, we tour because we want to play live, not just because, oh, well, you have to tour to, it's a marketing technique.
Sure.
Like, it is, but also I just want to play music with my friends on a stage. So, and then have a good time with everyone that comes to the show. Everything we do, is thought of from that perspective. And that's the foundation of Norma Jean. That's what it always has been. That's what I'm going to keep it that way. So it's more of a respect issue of what the band was even before me.
Nice. While we're on that video, I'm probably the only 311 fan in hardcore, but
no, you're
not. Where did you get the idea from for the whole, the video has the milk challenge thing. And I know 311, I don't know if it was the milk challenge or chocolate milk challenge, but if a fan could drink, like, you know, take a whole gallon of milk,
right,
they got $11. Did you get it from 311, or was it a thing you guys did too, or was it?
So this is actually a really good question based on where we just came from, because in the collective sense of things, sometimes how people contribute to Norma Jean is not even musical, so other members. So that video is directed by Norma Jean's original drummer, Daniel Davison.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And so that was his idea. We told him, we want to do something fun and almost kind of funny. And so that was his idea, is like, we'll have a backyard party, and instead of beer and alcohol and everyone throwing up at the end of it, it's milk and everyone throws up at the end of it, because it's the same. The same thing happens from both if you drink too much. It's just a funny concept from that. And so we really just had a real party. There was beer there. We just had to, like, people would just hide them behind things. And then it's like, okay, hide the beer and pick up the milk. And nice. we just had a really fun time that day, a pool party.
Nice. You know what? Actually, the video is perfect. And also the conversation you're having at the beginning, I got to tell you that I have this thing that I do where, and to me, I'm hilarious, but my wife's like, oh, you're endearing. But
me too.
I have where I show up to like a party, like an apartment, I'll knock on the door and I'll intentionally act like I'm having this really personal conversation, and they open the door to catch it. And I would do stuff like, I would do like, yeah, but I got the results back, and apparently it's, oh, hey! So
we do that. That's a funny joke. We do that at, like, if we're on tour, and someone's up there, like, ordering their food, and they kind of get done, and the person is, like, ringing it up, you know? You come up to them and go, dude, so she let you throw up in her mouth? And they and like the rule is like you have to say something crazy like that.
Yeah,
and the rule is they have to like keep a straight face and respond to it like, yeah, dude, it was, I couldn't believe it. Oh, thank you. Yeah, here's some money. And it's just a ridiculous, like, we were just having that conversation before he started ordering. And the looks on people's faces, no one ever responds. They just go, oh my gosh, I can't believe I'm hearing this.
Nice. Well, yeah. Well, I had several because this is my thing for years. Like, I want to make sure that, like, if I'm showing up at a party where there's, like, I'm not going to say who, but, like, there's a girl that's nervous. That's how I break the tension. Like, I would say anything. Like, yeah, I just shit my pants. And there was just, I didn't have any clean underwear. So I just went for it.
So, it's the funniest stuff. That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah. So after I saw that video, me and my buddy, my ex-guitarist, Eric, I used it one night. I knocked on the door at an apartment, and I was like, so apparently a restraining order is a pretty big deal. Oh, hey!
Yeah.
So I totally stole it.
Yeah, that's what we're doing in that video for sure, is that joke that you're talking about. So that's really awesome that you understand.
Nice. That's very cool. So I wanted to get back to a couple other recording moments. We definitely stayed on my first question for 30 minutes.
It's all good.
So I wanted to talk to you because I'm a big Deftones fan, and I love Chino. He's coming from a lot of really cool places with his influences. Mm-hmm. This is the Anti-Mother. You guys wrote together, and he also guest sung on Versus the Anti-Mother?
Yeah, so the entire, this really does work with all the questions that you were asking at the beginning of this, because in the collective sense, he if you're going to add someone to the name, add someone's name to the Wikipedia of members from that perspective, you need to add Chino then, I guess, because we do, everyone that works with us is in that zone. So we don't want to do just the first guest thing we've ever done. We didn't want it to be just a guest vocal because that guy's cool. We wanted that person to come in and write two songs with us. So we did it with Chino. We did it with Page from Helmet. If someone came in, they were a part of the song from the beginning. And so that's what that was. And then they sing on it or play guitar on it or whatever they want to do. And so that's what it was. Chino came. Actually, funny thing is, we asked Stefan. And it was more of a learning experience. We wanted to learn from these guys that we looked up to. To come in, like, hey, join the collective for a couple days, write a song or two with us, and then there's so much that you learn from that experience, just them playing guitar and you writing a song. And that's what that was, Stepan couldn't do it. He actually committed to it, was down, but they were in the middle of tracking and writing the album Arrows. That wasn't released.
Have you ever heard that?
No, I haven't. So
go ahead. Yes. Sorry.
But yeah, like they were doing that and he just didn't have time. So he said, I'm going to ask Chino if he'll do it. And Chino said, yeah. And he came down from the studio, stayed with us for 2 days. We wrote two songs. We used one of them and you get Surrender Your Sons. So yeah, that's what it was, is it's not just a guest vocal. It's that first riff is mine, and that second riff is his, and nice. The fourth one is Scotty's, and it there's something in at the end that Cove did. Cove from Seosin is on that song too, and it's just a big collective, like, let's just write a song with these guys and see what happens, and that's the song that came out.
Also, that album and Redeemer, you worked with Ross Robinson. What was that like? Did he throw chairs at you or make you cry, or was he super intense like you hear?
Yes, all that is real. So with Redeemer, he honestly, both albums, the beginning of the album, Ross was on crutches because he broke his leg. Doing motocross, and he had staples in his leg. The dude is just, I don't know, man, he's like indestructible or something, but so on Redeemer, he was on crutches for all of the main tracking and overdubs before vocals. And at one point, just on crutches, stands up from his chair, throws his crutches off, and tackles Durr, who's tracking one of the songs at the time. I think it's Grand Scene. At the end, you can hear this guitar just totally mess up. And that's him getting tackled by Ross.
Oh, my God.
The guitar just... Blam, blam, blam. Awesome. He had no idea it was coming. They end up on the ground. Ross is laughing his ass off. And then he was like, okay, just play it again and play it right. I won't tackle you this time. And then he played it right over it. So there's three guitars there. One of them is just him getting tackled. Nice. And, yeah, like, his whole thing is... and I, you know, I mean, this is one of my favorite stories because he did the first two Slipknot albums, and his whole thing with them is, look, if you're going to sing about this negative thing or whatever, like, you can't just come into the studio and say the words, like, you need to mean it. And he's like, he would say, like, I don't like negative stuff. I like positive stuff. But if that's what you're going to choose to sing about, then you better mean it. It's one of the biggest lessons that I've learned in music is to make sure that we mean it and not just to say stuff because, you know, we play pissed off rock and roll or whatever. So many lessons that we learned from him. But really, it's like band therapy in a way. And he makes sure everything is from an emotional standpoint of, the music means something. It's important. It's life or death. Don't just go in like and be whatever about it. Get those takes. Get those special takes and those special moments and that organic feeling as much as you can on the album. And that's what makes the record have energy. And then you listen to what Ross has done over the years. And that's, you know, Korn, Slipknot, Glassjaw. It's so much raw music.
Yeah.
So that's a Ross thing for sure. Yeah, he does that to wake you up.
Glassjaw's Everything You Ever Wanted to Know About Silence is definitely like a top 10 Desert Island record. And I'm not sure if this is true, but I heard that, you know, he has a Crohn's disease and it was very painful. He's had to cancel tours. I heard that the screaming parts, they wouldn't track unless he was having an attack. Like, that sounds like an urban legend, but, like, that's intense. Like, I want to hear the
pain. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, because I've seen him live, and the dude's phenomenal. Yeah. But everyone that – it might just depend on what he's doing at the time. I don't really know a lot of it. But everyone has a different approach to how they're going to do vocals. I definitely push really hard, and I have to always tell myself, push like 10 times less than you in your head you think you want to, or else you're going to blow yourself out, dude. I'm just telling myself that. I tell a lot of other vocalists that too, because it's really easy to want to go hard and
get,
you know, be that first song you just come out of the gate. I think it's more slow and steady wins the race. Chill at first and then see where you are that day. I mean, because you don't know. Your body's your instrument. You know, if you're in Denver and you're not from there, the altitude is insane. It's hard to breathe. It's your body. It's how you sing. So those days you need to be more chill. You know, in the South, it's humid. Like every element, what you did that day, if you got enough sleep or what your body is doing has an impact on your vocals. So I imagine that, you know, that's a struggle for him, but you would almost never know if you've seen that band live, because he's intense and he puts it all out there. He gets the, you know, no regard for life or limb, life or death thing. And he doesn't let, He doesn't use that as an excuse to not perform and not do what he's supposed to do. And I think it's great.
Nice. Angel Dust era, Mike Patton's like that too. Like sometimes I would just see him kill it so hard. I'm just like, no preservation for I'm gonna show tomorrow or
yeah,
like just you gotta respect it, you know, like yeah. Actually, speaking of that, you scream like balls out screaming and also have to sing. Do you do any kind of warm-ups or how do you sing and scream as gutturally as you do with as much diaphragm and not blow your vocals day two? Is that trick?
It's really a mix of young me self-teaching myself how to sing and not knowing what I'm doing, and years of practice and some lessons along the way that helped me refine that. But yeah, I just belt everything. Even the singing parts are mostly pretty belted. And I don't know, man, sometimes I listen to a song and I'm like, how am I doing that? That's crazy. But then, you know, we do it live and it's there. And a front of house engineer that used to work with us said that he really liked mixing my vocals because they're self-compressed. I'm the same volume everywhere. And that really just comes from me not knowing that I can work with compression as an effect to even all the levels out. And I just, I don't know. It's a little bit of mental work, physical work, but there's no warm-ups. I don't do anything. I just make sure I sleep, and that's the best.
So you don't sing scales by yourself, la 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 la, like nothing.
If I'm feeling like
weird as shit.
If I'm feeling a little bit like clogged up or something, I will.
Mm-hmm.
But I find that doing that has a little bit, because we're talking about a lot of elements that work together to make the instrument work. The first time I took lessons, I was with a guy named Ron Anderson. He's done like Red Hot Chili Peppers and Bjork and like Avenged Sevenfold and like this crazy stuff. Like one day I was leaving. It was one of my favorite stories to tell because it's just so random. But I was leaving my lesson and Hillary Duff was coming in after me. So, dude, it's
nice
so
name funny. Drop, bro.
Dude, that's the best name drop I can possibly have.
No, but, I'm not even mad. That's amazing.
Yeah, like it's just like, oh, hi, nice to meet you. See ya. But the one thing that I got from him was it felt like he was handing me this Dr. Seuss instrument with all these horns coming out, this weird buttons, like things, weird names, and like some trombone thing or whatever, and saying, here's what you've been trying to play this whole time. And I just like, oh, I have no idea. So all these elements come together and some of it's mental. So if I'm doing a lot of warm-ups, I'm too much in my head of like, oh my gosh, am I going to be okay tonight?
Oh yeah.
So my whole thing is just be loose, go up there and just chill. And then if I'm not as good that night, I'm not as good that night. I don't know. Sorry. I can't control but I'm not going to go, hey, sorry, everybody. Like, I'm not feeling very good. Or I'm sick today. Yeah. It's just like, I don't know. That's just how, you know, I that's the state I'm in. And then I just know that, okay, I need a day off or I need to sleep. So I'll just get done with that show. And like, as soon as everything's done, like, you know, thank God for the dudes in my band, cause they get it. Like, I'm like, I need to sleep. Cause with as much, intensities I'm putting into the vocals, if I don't sleep, I'm dead meat the next day.
Wow.
So it's all about rest and healing.
So this next record, you didn't work with Josh Barber, which is kind of like Terry Dates to Deftones. Like, it seems like a sixth member.
Yeah.
What, you guy, was that a sonic decision just to make a different sound, or what's up with that?
Yeah, it really just, you know, it keeps us from getting stagnant or comfortable. And it's just about, I mean, everything we do with every album is trying to find one thing that we can do that was a little bit different from the last thing we did. If we can find several things that we can change here and there, that helps us challenge ourselves. And so one of the things we wanted to do was just try something different, a little different thing sonically. And we liked what Will was doing. And once we got in the studio with him, we saw that his process was really organic, that fit us. So it ended up, you know, adding to it. And I think we will work with Josh again, for sure. I mean, we love working with him, and his style, and really just good hangs because we're just really good friends. So, yeah, you know, we wanted to just to mix it up and kind of make sure that we were in a different place. So that's really what it was. And I really like the way it came out. And I think it'll help us do the next thing. You know, there's always a transitional reason as well.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. Like, I've had this conversation with many of my friends that are in the Norma Jean, which is every record seems like almost a totally different band. Like, not a departure, like your vocals tied together, but on Oh God, the Aftermath, it was super heavy. It was very tech and very little vocal melody. Like, the hook was usually, you know, in the guitar. Then on Redeemer, you know, like a little bit of alternative, a lot more singing, a lot of melody. Anti-Mother was definitely more artsy, more alternative, still heavy, still Norma Jean.
Mm-hmm.
Meridial was more polished and heavy. Wrongdoers, it got raw, but punky, but still like that super heavy, punky, raw thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's my favorite one. Like, by the way,
awesome.
Wrongdoers is my jam.
Wrongdoers crew.
Yeah. No, we talked about that at the show. I was like, so what are you playing off Wrongdoers? Or I'm going to go home right now. And then Polar Similar was like more techie and still the Wrongdoers heavy and a little bit more polished. So I was like, so where are they going to go from here? Are there more hardcore metal options? And,
yeah.
You know, like where, what? So I'm looking forward to it. I'm glad there's only two songs I've heard because I'm looking forward to it. Like, I didn't want to come in with an opinion with this interview. That's badass.
Yeah, I think for All Hail, it's the punch and the contrast between dynamics. And it's, you know, I mean, it's going to have elements of the last 2.5-3 albums, but it really ended up, as much as we think we're experimenting and stepping out, it really ended up sounding like this is the next thing that we were supposed to do. So I'm really excited for people to hear the whole thing and hear what it really does, because it really does go into a whole different plane of existence for us as you go into the end of the album. I just can't wait to, and it's really story mode kind of thing. It's meant to be listened to from the beginning to the end, and it tells a story. And there's a concept, there's a theme that presented itself to us. It wasn't necessarily a calculated decision, and that's happened with every album, but I think with this one, it's a lot more prevalent and out front that it's there. And some people will pick up on it, some people won't. Either way, at the end of the day, it's still a rock album. So you still have fun with it, and it sounds incredible. It's pretty, when we were mixing, I was like, can that be louder? And he's like, yeah. And I was just like, how? Everything on this section is smashing. And he's like, yeah, there's plenty of room. I'm like, I don't get it. So it was just a different experience for us that I think it was good to get that kind of
nice
lesson learned in there.
Nice. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm already excited about this. It already sounds like you recorded like a pretty good record. It's like, you know what? I'm going to take these masters and dip it in some mud to see what happens. Like, it's got that raw thing, which is what I loved about Wrongdoers and Redeemer and Anti-Mother a little bit too. Like, pretty excited about that. Like, it sounds good. It's like got the tech of Polar Similar, but it's raw. Like, you know what? This guitar is feeding back. Let's leave that in there. It's like, sounds good.
Sick, dude.
Sick.
Yeah, you're going to like it, man. If you liked Polar Similar, and honestly, I do feel like this album does have a little bit of some Wrongdoers feels to it, because I mean with Polar Similar we went with a lot of atmosphere. So this album has a lot of that too, but it's just from a little different place sonically overall. So
sure,
it's just cool to hear Norma Jean with this type of production, and really, you know, when you're hearing those really tight cut parts, that's just Will making us play it again and play it again as a band until we play it right, until, you know, the part feels right, and him having a lot of ideas and pushing us really hard to pay attention to our instruments, but also making sure that the loose vibe of Norma Jean is there, and the emotional stuff and all the contrast and dynamics is all still there. So he really made sure that he didn't, you know, go, now you guys come over here, do this, you know, change the band or whatever.
Right.
He respected what we do and just added his kind of, you know, take on some things. It's really cool that it came out the way it did.
Nice. I'm looking forward to it. So I got one last question. Do you remember that time that you guys did a tour, 10-year anniversary of Oh God, The Aftermath, where you played the record from front to back live? Remember that?
Yeah, of course I do. Yeah, that was late 2015, I think.
Okay, that was awesome. Tell me you got the reference.
Yes. Oh, you mean the best interviews I've ever seen in my life?
Yeah, well, no, the Chris Farley
dude. That's for real. Like, that was awesome.
All right, guys. Corey Brandon. This next track is With Errors from the upcoming record All Hail, dropping October 25th. Enjoy.